Hello, and welcome everyone to your National World War I Museum and Memorial. My name is Camille Kulig, Public Program Specialist, and I am thrilled to have everyone joining us here this evening. As we continue to commemorate the centennial years of the war, tonight we'll turn our attention a little closer to home as we examine how the U.S. Armed Forces played pivotal roles in key military engagements of 1918. This week at the Museum and Memorial, we have a lot of exciting events happening that I'd like to alert everyone to. This Thursday, June 28th, we'll present Voices of the Western Front, a mesmerizing concert experience that tells the story of English composer George Butterworth, Olympic gold medalist Frederick Kelly, and French composer Albrecht Magnard, and a musical immersion of the three men's lives during World War I. Be sure not to miss this evocative musical journey brought to life as you've never seen before. On Friday, June 29th, we'll open our special exhibition for Liberty, American Jewish Experience in World War I. It'll examine the American Jewish battlefield and home front participation through a series of remarkable objects and stories. We hope you can come back and see it. For more information on our upcoming programs, exhibitions, and membership, please feel free to visit our website, theworldwar.org. And now to introduce Lieutenant Colonel Richard S. Faulkner. He is a longtime friend and supporter of the Museum and Memorial, and someone we are proud and fortunate to call part of our community here. Not only has Sean presented at two of our Centennial Symposia, he is a top performer on YouTube and a perennial favorite at our Day in the Life programs. Sean teaches and chairs the Military Department, the Department of Military History at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College, and has served 23 years in the U.S. Army and commanded a tank company and the 1st Armored Division during Operation Desert Storm. In addition to his service and teaching, Sean has contributed indelibly to the World War I nonfiction canon. His first book, The School of Hard Knocks, Combat Leadership and the American Expeditionary Forces, received the Society for Military History's 2013 Distinguished Book Award, while his second, Pershing's Crusaders, The American Soldier in World War I, received the World War I Association's 2017 Norman B. Tomlinson Jr. Prize for the Best Work of History in English on World War I, and the Army Historical Foundation's 2017 Excellence in U.S. Army History Book Award. It is with great pleasure that we warmly welcome Richard S. Faulkner to our stage.
What's that? Why, thank you.
You're welcome. I couldn't take the moment.
There we go.
Not reach you, say welcome to the spotlight, sir.
Thanks, Laura. Good evening. Hey, it is always a great pleasure to speak here at the National World War I Museum. Now, I got to say, it must be a very slow Tuesday night. Get everybody out here on a nice hot evening. A couple of months back, the museum sponsored Paul Herbert from the Cantini Museum, 1st Infantry Division Cantini Museum in Illinois. And he spoke about the first real American Battle of the War at Cantini in May of 1918. I'm basically going to pick up where Paul left off. 100 years ago this summer, the American Army in France is finally making a contribution to the war. 100 years ago. Now, the war started in April of 1917, and so you got to think about this, that it took us a year to just get barely 300,000 men overseas. And the combat that they had seen in that year was really nothing more than a few raids, a few skirmishes. And before we get started on understanding the realities that these armies, these troops are going to face in June, July, and August of 1918, it's really important to sort of go back from the beginning, because the systemic problems that the American Army faced in mobilizing this force for war is going to indelibly influence how this army fights in the summer and basically for the rest of the war. Now, one thing we got to understand, that when the United States enters the war in April of 1917, the U.S. Army is ranked 17 in the world, behind Portugal and Romania. Now, on a good day, with a good win, we'd probably beat the hell out of the Montenegrins, but, you know, that's a coin flip. Now, this is basically because the Americans had long had an aversion to a large standing military. It's detrimental to your pocketbook. It's detrimental to your liberties. And we actually weren't very sure that we wanted to get involved with the war at all. So if you look at the size of our army, right around 300,000 men, and that includes the National Guard. This is going to be a problem, because when we enter the war, Woodrow Wilson has a pretty expansive idea of what he wants this war to accomplish. That ultimately, he wants the United States to have a major role and crafting the new world order that the peace will bring. The problem is, if you're going to earn that place at the peace conference, you're going to have to make a major contribution to the war. And it can't just be with the Navy. You're going to have ground troops actually on the ground in France. And the War Department does an estimation to accomplish the president's expansive goals. The army was going to have to go from 300,000 men to over 4 million. That's not bad enough. You have an officer corps of under 3,000. It's going to have to expand to over 200,000. Now, fortunately, we have been watching what the Europeans were doing. And we learn most importantly from the British and their experience in going from a small constabulary army based upon volunteers to a large continental army. And so even before the war begins, the Wilson administration has already decided that the majority of these troops will be raised by the draft, breaking with a long-standing American tradition. And the last time we had done the draft in the American Civil War, it had not turned out very well. In fact, there have been riots in American cities. Now, surprisingly, the draft goes very well. And by the time the war ends in November of 1918, we've raised over 4 million men and sent over 2 million of them to France. We're going to have a slightly harder time in raising our corps of officers and NCOs. Now, prior to the war, most of our officers came from West Point, the Citadel, Norwich, VMI. And if we're going to raise the officers here, we can't rely on those traditional sources for this 200,000-man officer corps. The Army is faced with no other option, so basically, in May of 1917, they establish a number of officer training camps at places across the United States. These camps are designed to give these officer candidates 3 months of training. And at the end of these 3 months of training, these officers are supposed to be able to go across the street to the new units that are being stood up as the draftees are just starting to fill them in. Now, the problem is that when you start establishing these camps, you have less than 3 weeks to do it. The Army is very short of trained cadre to educate the officers. They're short of equipment, and they're actually short of a good modern doctrine. Some of the officer candidates will say, you know, I really didn't get much out of this. The officers didn't understand modern war. In fact, one said that the only thing I did was spend 3 months reenacting Civil War field problems through the mosquito-filled swamps of Arkansas. Now, after 3 months of training, when they show up in the units, the enlisted soldiers have a name for them. They call them 90-day wonders. Now, that's not meant as a compliment. It's not, oh, these guys are wonderful. It's, we wonder how the hell they ever got commissions. Now, it's going to be bad enough having these officers that are really unready for the challenges of fighting modern war. We're also going to face problems creating a cadre of non-commissioned officers. Now, non-commissioned officers are the backbone of every army. They're responsible for the individual training and discipline of the soldiers under them. Now, the old regular army plan for training NCOs was to put, you know, good, well-trained soldiers under the tutelage of experienced officers and long-service NCOs and basically have them undergo a long-service apprenticeship. This is not going to work when you start to expand this army. So what often happens are the draftees that show up on Monday become the NCOs for the draftees that show up on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Now this is all. Inexperienced officers, inexperienced NCOs are going to create some massive problems for this new army. What you're going to start seeing is the blind leading the blind. And it's not that the officers and NCOs didn't want to do well, they simply don't know any better. They're the ones that are supposed to be responsible now for training the platoons and the companies and even the battalions of this expanding army. And officers will often say, I stayed up all night learning how to disassemble the 1911 pistol so I could train my soldiers how to do it the next day. But despite all of that dedication, it's still not going to be enough to prepare these formations for the challenges that they're going to face. Now, in addition to those personnel issues, there are also some big issues when it comes to equipment and weapons. We have a small army with very few arsenals to provide the weapons. And when we enter the war, the rifle that we're using, the 1903 Springfield, is only being made in one place, Springfield Arsenal, Massachusetts. That weapon is almost handmade. And so when the Army says we're going to have an army of 4 million men, the Springfield Arsenal says, that's nice. What are you going to arm them with? We can't mass produce that weapon. Now, the great German Chancellor Otto von Bismarck had a great saying. He said, God has a special providence for drunks, small children, and the United States of America. We're actually fortunate that we have a rifle that Winchester and Remington are building for the British Army called the Pattern 1914 and British caliber 303. And when Springfield cannot turn out enough of those 1903 rifles, the Army turns to Winchester and Remington and says, can you take that British rifle, rechamber it from 303 to the American 30-06 caliber and mass produce it? Fortunately, they can. And that rifle on the right, will become the 1917, the weapon that equips over 70% of the American soldiers in the war. But it's still going to take time for them to retool. And so in the midst of this mobilization, what oftentimes happens, our soldiers are training with wooden rifles or obsolete rifles, waiting to get the rifles they're going to use in combat. Some units never get the rifles in time before they ship overseas. Because in the pace of deploying divisions as soon as they can to France, if one division is slated to go and it doesn't have its rifles, they'll take them from another division further down in the deployment list. One of the regiments of the 4th Division will receive almost no marksmanship training before the soldiers get on the transports. Now, if you're having problems with basic rifles, you can imagine the problems they're having with more complex weapons like machine guns and artillery pieces. In fact, the majority of the American machine gunners and artillerymen will not see the weapons that they're actually going to fight with until after they arrive in France. Now, to add to that misery, there are also acts of God that are going to disrupt the American mobilization and training. The winter of 1917 is one of the worst in the 20th century, and you get deep accumulations of snow as far south as Florida. And what happens is this bad weather and then the thaws that follow, creating fields of mud, keep the soldiers inside for much of the winter of 1917-1918. And if that's not bad enough, outbreaks of measles and mumps and then ultimately the Spanish influenza are also going to lead to soldiers being isolated for weeks and weeks at a time, keeping them from being trained. Now, this is going to be a problem because while the Americans are trying painfully to mobilize this mass army, and as we have spent all the years since 1914 protecting the border, some things never change, chasing Mexican banditos, the Europeans have been essentially inventing modern war. And I got a couple of slides here to sort of show you the details of how big of a change this is. On the left is an American infantry regiment in 1916. Almost all the soldiers are equipped with rifles. You have a provisional machine gun company, which means the army giveth, the army taketh away. That's that same infantry regiment just a little over a year and a half later. Some of the weapons that this regiment is equipped with, is armed with, had not even been invented when the war broke out in August of 1914. Now, to show at the micro level how that plays out, here's a platoon. And infantry squads and infantry platoons are the building blocks of all armies. And they're undergoing even a greater degree of change than the larger units. The unit on the left, infantry platoon of April 1917, all equipped with rifles except for the officers' pistols. There's that same platoon a little over a year later. And I color-coded this because when you get new weapons like grenade launchers, hand grenades, Shosho automatic rifles, and new tactics and new organization, that requires a mastery of a lot more skill sets, not only by the individual soldiers, but also, perhaps more importantly, from their officers and NCOs. So every different color that you see on the right is a different specialty that these very green officers and NCOs have to master. Nobody understands this problem greater than John J. Pershing, the commander of the American Expeditionary Force. He recognizes that there had been major problems with the American mobilization, that no two divisions that arrive in France have the same degree or standardization of training. He also understands that the Americans are going to go up against some very tough fighters. Now, this is not the first time in American history where we had to go through a massive mobilization to fight a big war. In fact, only 50 years before, both the North and the South had had to raise mass armies. But the problems are different. In fact, in 1861, as the Union Army is starting to build, the commander of what will become known as the Army of the Potomac is a guy named Irwin McDowell. And McDowell is always pawning off the president. Lincoln wants him to take his army, move south, destroy the rebellion. And every time he pushes McDowell, McDowell says, "My army is not trained, my army is not ready." Finally, Lincoln gets tired of that. Turns to him and says, "It is true, you are green, but they are green also. You are all green alike." That's not the issue here. Because when the Americans show up, they're McDowell's army. They are very apple green. But the enemy that they're going to face has been doing this since 1914, and they've gotten very good. They've got especially good at using defensive tactics, how to incorporate machine guns and artillery and field entrenchments to create multiple dilemmas for the attacking force. Pershing realizes that he's got to fundamentally change the mindset and the organization and the tactics and the technology of this small constabulary force to get it ready to meet those Germans. He has a plan. Every division in the AEF will now undergo a 3-month-long standardized training plan. The first month will be correcting all those problems with weapons and basic training. So platoons, squads, companies, up to battalions and regiments will be issued with the weapons they couldn't get in the United States and will learn those basic tactics. After that first month, regiments, American regiments, will then move into quiet sectors of the Allied front, into the trenches, quiet sectors of the trenches, where they will be seasoned to battle but also learn trench warfare. And at the end of that month, they will now come back and start large unit training at the brigade and division level to learn open warfare, how to fight out of the trenches. Now, this is a pretty good plan. Pershing also has his fingers on the pulse of what's going on. He realizes that by the end of 1917, the British and the French armies are having some serious problems filling their ranks. He's also hoping that the German army is increasingly on the rope. He believes that if he can get his army deployed to France, get them trained under his training system, that by 1919, the Americans will be the only Allied army left that can actually bring victory against the Germans. Sounds good. The problem with all military plans, though, is before you issue them, you should always check with the enemy. Because the enemy, as we all say in the Army, gets a vote. Now, the Army war effort in 1916 for the end of the war are led by these two guys, the gruesome twosome. Paul von Hindenburg and Eric Ludendorff, with Eric Ludendorff really being the brain and Pinky in the brain here, the one who is directing most of the German war effort. Ludendorff understands that the Americans are coming. He basically understands that because he screwed up the situation that got him there to start off with. He recognizes, though, that he has a very small window of opportunity to win the war. With the Russian Revolution of March and then later October of 1917, the Russians are essentially out of the war. So the Germans have the possibility of ending the problem of a two-front war. What Ludendorff hopes to do was, with a series of offensives, take all of these extra troops that have been pushed up against the Russians, move them to France, come up with a war-winning strategy that will end this conflict before the American numbers can tell. And so on the 21st of March, 1918, he begins with Operation Michael. And it's designed to crush the British Army, move in behind it, push towards the English Channel, cut them off from their logistics, and either then destroy the British Army in detail or force them off the continent. What this does is creates a crisis in the Allied ranks. You can imagine. In a series of 3 or 4 days, the Germans have basically pushed the British all the way back to where they started in the Somme offensive of 1916. And it looks like the Allies might crack. In the midst of this crisis, and the finger pointing that follows, one of the members of the Supreme Allied War Council is General Robertson of the British Army. He says, well, wait a minute, before we get too crazy about this, we have nearly 300,000 Americans that maybe we can use. But let's be honest. Have you seen these guys lately? They're basically untrained, and more importantly, their officers are horrible. They have no experience in leading large operations. What would be best would be to amalgamate these Americans, take them, break them into regiments, and put them in well-led British and French organizations. Now, in the midst of this crisis, he turns to the American representative of the Allied War Council, Tasker Bliss, that guy with a rockin' mustache in the middle, and under some pressure and some dire predictions of what will happen if the Americans don't cooperate, Bliss basically caves and agrees to a French and British argument that for the time being, for April through July of 1918, the Americans will only ship over infantry and machine gun units to France. And that these units would then be used as needed by the Allied High Command to deal with the crisis. Now, that's not going to sit well with John J. Pershing. He recognizes that if you just send infantrymen and machine gunners, you are going to lack the artillery and the key logistic personnel that you're going to need to put together divisions and corps and ultimately an independent American army. Now, Pershing is a very canny bureaucratic fighter, and he's not going to take this sitting down. He sort of maneuvers behind the lines. He meets with British representatives in London and says, you know, I know that I'm dependent upon you for shipping, but I also know that you want the Americans in France. And I'll make a deal with you. How about this? For the month of May, I will send American 6 divisions worth of American infantrymen and machine gunners. And I'll put them in British sectors. But then you agree, in June, you send over all of their artillery. And as shipping space becomes available in that same 2 to 3 months, you will then ship over their logistics organizations. Now, the British, of course, understanding these Americans will be in the British sector, jump on this. And Pershing thinks he's actually done something pretty slick, right up to the moment that the French find out that they've had a march stolen on them. And Foch goes through the roof. And finally, at Abbeville, Pershing has to sheepishly agree to ship machine gunners and infantrymen up through June, knowing damn well that the British are going to agree to continue to ship the artillery. But he has managed to turn away from this argument of taking American units and amalgamating them into existing Allied formations. Now, Pershing also realized he's going to have to give. And 7 days after the beginning of Operation Michael, he approaches Foch and tells him that the Americans will do whatever is necessary in this crisis to help the Allies out. But the one thing he's not going to bend on is that only under extreme circumstances will the American divisions be broken up and their component pieces be sent into the line. And this is going to lead to a very frosty relationship between Foch and Pershing that will last throughout the war. The agreement, though, is now that these American divisions that have not really completed all their training will be sent to quiet sectors of the Allied lines, where they will occupy the front, thus freeing up veteran French divisions to be used in more active sectors. Well, this plan is actually pretty workable, except again, they don't check it with Ludendorff. Now, Ludendorff has launched one offensive, Operation Michael, and it grinds to a halt after a couple of weeks. Then he launches another offensive, Operation Georgette, and again, it grinds to a halt after a couple of weeks. Ludendorff realizes that the sands are running out in the hourglass, and he's starting to get desperate. He decides he's going to launch another major operation. This time it's going to be across the old Chemin des Dames battlefield. And Operation Blücher is again his idea of how to quickly win the war. He's going to mass his artillery, mass his divisions, push across the Chemin des Dames ridge, and push towards the Marne River. Now, contrary to what the Americans will say in the summer of 1918, the goal of this operation is not to capture Paris. All that Ludendorff is trying to do is to threaten Paris, because he knows well that if he can threaten Paris, the French are going to be likely to take all the reserves they have behind the British lines and move them to protect Paris. And as soon as they move those reserves to protect Paris, Ludendorff will then launch his war-winning campaign against the British Army in Flanders with the same idea he had for Michael. Push in, cut the British logistics lines to their channel ports, and either force them from the continent or destroy them in detail. Now, when this operation starts off, just like Michael's, it goes extremely well in the beginning. And in 7 days of fighting, they push the French army back over 35 miles, ending on the Marne River at Chateau Thierry. But Foch doesn't take the bait. He prevents Petain from moving 15 divisions to reinforce the area. But he has to change his plan for the Americans. In the midst of this crisis, he takes two green American divisions, the 2nd Division and the 3rd Division, and moves them not to a quiet sector, but to backstop this threatened area on the Marne River. Now, the Americans are going to claim that the actions that they're going to fight in early June save Paris. Again, nothing can be further from the truth. In fact, by the time these two divisions actually arrive on the front, the German offensive has already ground to a halt. And only one American unit, the 7th Machine Gun Battalion of the 3rd Division, is actually involved in any meaningful way in stopping the German drive at Chateau Thierry. And even they are only supporting the brave fighting of the French Senegalese forces, doing house-to-house combat in Chateau Thierry to grind the German advance down. But now you have these two units, and the stage is set for the first real combat for American forces in the war. And these combats are going to be legendary. In fact, we're going to start here with the 2nd Division and the Battle of Belleau Woods and Vaux, 100 years ago. No battle, American battle of the war, is more wrapped up in folklore and legend as this engagement. Now, when the Americans arrive, the 2nd Division has not completed its training, and it's a pretty sketchy organization. And when they come, they fall under the command of Jean de Gaute of the French 21st Corps. And when these Americans arrive, de Gaute is really not sure if they're up to the task of holding the line. And again, I love this battle because there's some great quotes that come out of it. The Americans come in, and the first thing they report are the French are moving in panicked waves, going past them. Now, there's probably some truth to that, but you never judge an army by what you see in its rear. That's what really is happening is the major French fighting forces are grinding the Germans to a halt. One of the great stories that comes out of here is from a Marine Corps captain named Lloyd Williams. And he no sooner arrives into his sector west of Chateau Thierry, when a French officer arrives and says, "It's time for you to pull back." And what he is reported to have said, think about those words I'm using, you'll hear them again, reported to have said was, "Retreat, hell, we just got here." Okay? Now, reported to have said, which should send off some warning signs, and the fact that I'm using passive voice, reported to have said. But it's a great story. Now, when the Americans do arrive, de Gucht's plan is to take the regiments and divide them up and send them to French divisions, contrary to what Pershing had said, because, again, he's not sure that these Americans can stand. Another great quote comes out of this. In the midst of this heated discussion, the chief of staff of the division, a guy named Preston Brown, long service regular officer, turns to him and says, "General, these are American regulars. They have not been beaten in 150 years. Another great quote, right? Now, here's a problem. I'm a student of American military history. Seems to forget that 40-odd years before, there was a guy named George Armstrong Custer who had sort of been beaten. I'm also from Georgia, okay? And so I have a memory of about 50 years before this, some of my ancestors beating the hell out of a couple of Yankees. I'm just saying. But again, it makes a very good quote, and it shows the tenacity of the Americans and their aggressiveness. Soon after that line stabilizes, though, de Gucht is a very aggressive commander. The Germans have pushed hard against the French. It's time for payback. And so on the 5th of June, he brings in the 2nd Division and the 106th French Division commander and says, "Tomorrow I want you to attack. I want you to drive the Germans back from the high ground that they have captured in our sector." Now, the 2nd Division is an important, unique organization in the AEF. It's unique in the fact that you have the 3rd Infantry Brigade, U.S. Army, made it up with the 4th Marine Brigade. And almost all of the combat Marines in the American Expeditionary Force are in that brigade. So you've got sort of these weird organizations together. Now, where are my Marines? I know I got a couple of them. Don't be too embarrassed, okay? We're going to talk a lot about the Marine Corps here. So you've got these two great brigades together. The Marine Brigade is under the command of James Harbert, who always liked to wear a French helmet. Don't ask me why. I guess it looks really cool on him. And the American Brigade with the 23rd, or Army Brigade, and the 23rd and 9th Infantry under Richard Lewis. Both of these are experienced commanders. The division commander is Omar Bundy. He's older than John J. Pershing, so he's sort of up there in years. And Pershing, even before this battle, is not sure that Bundy has the aggressiveness and know-how to command a division. So he's already looking for an excuse to relieve him, but can't pull that trigger before they're thrown into battle. Bundy's plan for the attack that will come off on the 6th of June is to make the main effort with the Marine Brigade under Harbert. And his plan is to use that brigade to clear the high ground, the hills that are overlooking, the hills and Belleau Wood that are overlooking Lucy-le-Bocage and Bruch. That by doing that, it's going to weaken the German line and accomplish de Gucht's goals. He's going to then use the 3rd Infantry Brigade to just do limited attacks. That they're going to do limited attacks in their sector to fix the Germans in place to keep them from moving reinforcements against the Marines. Now, the 6th of June, the opening of the Battle of Belleau Woods, is going to go down in the myth and lore of the Marine Corps. And it's a debacle. Where are my Marines? It's a disaster. And it's a disaster for a couple of reasons. Some are due to the fact that these troops are inexperienced. That they fail to do, the Marines fail to do a good recon of the routes that they're going to cover and of the objectives that they have to face. And also because they have not yet mastered how to take their formations and their tactics with their weapons against the terrain and enemy that confront them. The biggest problem, though, goes back to James Harbert. The division and the brigade commanders are responsible for fire support. And in World War I, artillery is a big killer. 70% of the casualties are caused by artillery in the war. And if you cannot make artillery work, you cannot make combat work in World War I. And they do not do adequate artillery preparation. So when the Marines start to move forward, they go across 300 meters of open ground without adequate artillery support, without a rolling barrage, and dense wave formations. Harbored also listened to false reports that there actually weren't a lot of Germans in those woods, despite the fact that aviators had flown over the top and said, "We see a lot of Germans messing around there." So when the Marines move forward on the 6th of June, they're mown down left and right. In fact, by the end of the day, the Marines will suffer nearly 1,100 casualties. They will lose more men, the entire number of Marines that have been lost since its founding in 1775 up to that point. And the first day of the Battle of Belleau Woods will go only second to the first day of the Battle of Tarawa as the bloodiest day in Marine Corps history. And it doesn't get much better after that. For the next 10 days, the Marines will bash their faces up against these German defenses. And the Germans will counterattack every time the Marines get a toehold. And then the Germans will drop mustard gas on top of them. It's a truly miserable experience. And finally, after 10 days of bashing their face up against the defenses, the Marines are exhausted. And Bundy agrees to take the 7th Infantry Regiment on loan from the 3rd American Division and do a relief in place. Now this is, again, is sort of a disaster. And again, this goes back to James Harbord. Because when the 7th Infantry Regiment attacks on the 16th of June, they're going to make the exact same mistakes that the Marines had done on the 6th of June. And the lack of artillery prep and the lack of intel support all goes back to Harbord, at least in my estimation. And these Army soldiers will bash their faces up against the German defenses for 8 more days until the regiment becomes combat ineffective. They're taken out of the line, and the Marines are put back in. But the Marines have learned some wisdom. So for the attack that they're going to launch on the 25th of June, the artillery plan is detailed, and it's adequate for the task. And so for after 2 days of fighting, on the 25th and the 26th of June, 100 years ago today, the Marines captured Belleau Woods. Now, I'd like to talk about lore here, because lore matters. I got my Marines here, and I'm an Army guy, I gotta confess, right? And so all Army guys will joke that a Marine rifle squad consists of 5 riflemen, 5 photographers, and 2 public affairs officers, right? Don't leave home without them. and there's some truth to there. Hey, this battle is important in Marine Corps history because it finally puts the Marine Corps on the map. That when the war begins in 1917, there's only 13,000 Marines in the Navy. And if you were to ask the average American on the street, "Hey, tell me about the Marine Corps," he'd look at you like you were strange. "I don't know what you're talking about. What's a Marine Corps?" The Marines are very good. When the war breaks out, the first thing they do is come out with that poster. First to fight. You see, until August of 1918, if you wanted to enlist in the U.S. military, you had to enlist in an existing National Guard, regular Army, or Marine Corps unit. And so when the Marines say, "First to fight, join now and test your courage," real fighting for real fighters, the people that the Marines get in 1917 and early 1918 are those ardent young men who are looking for adventure and want to fight. So they get some pretty good guys. They also get very good press. Again, the quotes that come out of this battle are some of my favorites. One of them is this one that makes Laura cringe, okay? In the midst of the first day's battle, 6 June, Dan Daly, legendary Marine, had already won 2 medals of honor. When his troops are pinned down, First Sergeant Dan Daly reputedly grabs his rifle, stands up in the midst of the fire, turns to his troops and says, "Come on, you sons of bitches, do you want to live forever?" Now I've got a young boy's puerile love of saying dirty words in public, okay? But you've got to love that quote. Problem is, we're never really sure if he actually said it. Where it comes from is this guy in the annals of Marine Corps history. He's a correspondent, Floyd Gibbons, from the Chicago Tribune. And that quote, "Come on, you sons of bitches, do you want to live forever?" actually comes from something that he hears secondhand, supposedly from a Marine Corps gunnery sergeant. Now, after the war, somebody will ask Daly if that's what he says. He says, I don't know, I was sort of busy. What I think I said was, "For Christ's sakes, boys, get up. Do you want to live forever?" But again, the story's not as good. How many of you guys have ever seen The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance? Anybody ever seen that old John Ford, John Wayne movie? There's a great line in that movie that describes the Marine Corps. When legend becomes fact, print the legend. The Marine Corps are going to take this battle and make it the core of their myth and ethos for the rest of the 20th century, on to today. In fact, Teufelhorn, Devil Dogs, comes out of the Battle of Belleau Woods. And again, the Germans are reported to have called the Marines Devil Dogs. Now the problem is, Devil Dogs is not really a word that's used much in German, okay? Now there's an American doughboy from the 42nd Division who had his own take on this. He said, "Let me tell you something. The Germans had nicknames for the rainbows that would make Devil Dogs sound like sissies. And besides, the Marines made up that Devil Dogs name themselves." Now, here's a reality, though. You are asking 19 and 20-year-olds to do stuff that common sense and instinct tells them not to do. So if it's a little bit of myth and legend perpetrated by guys like Floyd Gibbons to get guys to stand up and follow Dan Daly across that fire-swept ground, sometimes in war, that's what you need. Now, while the Marines and the Army soldiers, I forgot the Army soldiers, they're sort of pissed off that they're left out of the glory of the Marines. But they also watch very well. And so when the American Army 3rd Brigade is finally allowed to do their own attack on the 1st of July, 1918, they do after 24 hours of an artillery preparation on the French town of Vaux. And they go over the top and reach their objectives with minimal casualties. But where's the fun story in that? Now, while the 2nd Division is fighting outside of Belleau Woods and Vaux, Ludendorff is going to roll his last dice. He recognizes now that the sands are quickly running out. So he's going to last one major offensive. He calls it Friedenssturm, which is German for peace offensive. Okay? All you budding strategists out there, never call a battle the peace offensive. It gives Joe too much hope, gives the soldier too much hope. His idea is to take and basically reduce the French stronghold at Rennes. He's already tried to bash his face against this a couple of times, so his new plan is to launch attacks on either side of the city, come in around the flanks, take that, and then be in a position where, again, the French will be forced to move their reserves away from the British sector to reinforce this. As the German Chancellor, von Hertling, will say, these 3 days, the history of the world played out in 3 days, that this is the last roll for the Germans. The French are actually quite good at backstopping this, but in this case, they have the assistance of the U.S. 3rd Division. Just like the 2nd Division, it's pretty green, and it had already been defending around Chateau Thierry since the 30th of May. The commander, though, is quite different. Joseph Dickman had been a long service regular. He had taught at the Army War College. He had been on the Army staff, so frankly, he's quite smarter than Bundy and Harbert. In fact, he's smart enough to know when to disobey his commander. The 3rd Division is again under that aggressive French commander, Jean de Gout. And when de Gout understands that the Germans are attacking toward Chateau Thierry, he orders Dickmann to take his division and defend along the riverfront. Dickmann says, wait a minute now, I've been studying war for a long time. If I defend in this flat ground along the river, these high grounds, all this high ground north of the river, will dominate my position, and the Germans will be able to pour machine gun and artillery fire upon me. So he decides he's going to disobey the French commander and array his division in depth. So rather than sit up here, he's going to take his units and sort of stagger them down through the terrain. And despite this, the Germans are still coming for bear. In fact, when they begin their attack against this position on the 15th of July, they manage to make 6 very bloody river crossings of the Marne. And at a key point of the battle, another American officer sort of saves the day by again disobeying his orders. The guy in charge of the 38th Infantry Regiment is Ulysses Grant McAlexander. Now that's a pretty, you know, military name, Ulysses Grant McAlexander. As the Germans come in, they hit a weak point in the line here and are following this valley with a stream bed deep into the American positions. And from Dickmann's position, it looks like the American defenses are about to collapse. And he orders McAlexander to launch an all-out attack with all the forces he has to try to stem the German advance. Now McAlexander says, okay, it doesn't make good sense of me to do a counterattack against forces that outnumber me. So rather than launch that counterattack, what I'm going to do is bend my forces. Keep to the high ground here. Let the Germans penetrate, because the deeper they penetrate, the weaker they're going to get, and I'll be able to bring fire against them from 3 different sides. Fortunately, the 3rd Division holds, and the defensive division, specifically the 30th and 38th Infantry Regiments, will lead the 3rd Division to this day to be called the Rock of the Marne. But again, the Americans didn't save Paris, because that was not the Germans' intent. But in the midst of this, Ferdinand Foch sees an opportunity. He's been wanting to go on the counteroffensive since the 20th of May, 1918. And what he's noticed, that each time Ludendorff launches an offensive, they seem to be getting weaker and weaker. And with the failure of the Friedensturm, he realizes that his time to launch the counterattack has now dawned. The Germans have a deep salient between Soissons and Rennes, pushed down towards Chateau Thierry. But the problem with the salient is it's vulnerable to its flanks. So what Foch does is bring together 30 French divisions and 8 American divisions for a counterattack. And you got to understand that every one of those American divisions are about the size of a French corps. So for this counterattack, 25% of the forces will actually be Americans. His goal is to use Charles Mangin's 10th Army with the 1st and 2nd U.S. Infantry Divisions to cut the throat of the salient at the top by Soissons. And by driving against the throat of the salient, he will either bag all the Germans inside the salient or make it so dangerous that the Germans will be forced to withdraw. Now, when this attack begins, the 1st and 2nd Divisions have been pretty badly battered by the Battle of Cantigny and the Battle of Belleau Woods and Vaux. And they received a lot of replacements, but they're still ready to go. When the attack begins, though, the guy who's commanding the 2nd Division is our old friend James Harbord, and he really hasn't learned a lot of lessons. So when the Americans move forward, their attacks are uncoordinated, and the infantry are not going forward with the artillery. So they're very bloody. In fact, after 4 days fighting, the 1st Division loses nearly 7,000 casualties, and the 2nd Division loses 4,300 casualties. But their sacrifice is paying off, because a day into the battle, Ludendorff orders the Germans to start a delay. Now, while this battle is going on up here, simultaneously, other American divisions with our newly promoted good friend Jean de Goutte are going to push in from the south. Now, he will have under his control the 1st U.S. Corps under Hunter Liggett. Now, this is the first time that a U.S. Corps has been committed to combat, and Hunter Liggett's the right guy for it. Another American general who's brighter than the average bear. And Liggett understands that he has to prove the American prowess in the battle. So they're going to push forward. It's going to be some ugly fighting. The guy who commands the 26th Division is a guy named Clarence Edward, a guy who almost everybody else in the AEF except his soldiers hate his guts. And his dilatory attacks on the opening days of this battle is going to further convince Pershing to get rid of him at the first possible opportunity. But two more months will go by before they can do it. But this attack is actually quite successful. You will notice, though, that there are French units interspersed between the American ones. This is because even now, Foch is not sure that the Americans can stand on their own. So they're going to make sure that there are good seasoned French divisions in between. And even in the First Corps, Liggett will command not only an American division, but also a French division. And this will mark the first time since the American Revolution that an American commander will have control over a large foreign force. It actually goes pretty well. And finally, on the 4th of August, Liggett's First Corps will be joined by Ballard's Third Corps. And no French units will be in between them. So the first time you have two large American units moving in unison against the enemy. And this is going to help set the foundation for the establishment of the American First Army under Pershing. At the end, this operation is quite bloody, but it's also very successful. Now, I'm going to talk about these two real quick and then wrap up with why the summer of 1918 matters. Foch has been right. When the Battle of Soissons or en Marne ends on the 6th of August, he recognizes he has a singular victory. 2 days later, the British will have another major victory at the Battle of Amiens. And the combination of those two victories are starting to lead Foch to believe that the Allies might actually be able to win the war in 1918. But like all good commanders, when they've had success, he wants to continue to build on that success. And so even though he has promised, finally given Pershing permission to establish the independent American army with its own sector of the front, he says, for a small period of time, I want to retain 5 American divisions and the 3rd Corps to help me exploit the victories that we have won at Soissons. So, OA's offensive, how about that for French, huh? I had to work on that quite a bit. These divisions are going to move forward to help continue pushing the Germans back from the front. Now, there's going to be some hard fighting here. In fact, the 28th Division will earn its nickname, Bloody Buckets, for its attacks at Fismes and Fismettes in the early part of the offensive. Pershing insisted the 3rd Division and the White Divisions be returned to the AEF in time to participate in the Meuse-Argonne. Because 2 of the divisions that are given to the French, the 92nd and the 93rd, are the African-American combat units of the AEF. And the AEF, he had already promised the 93rd, it's never really formed as a division, it fights with the French throughout the war, and the 92nd will also see its combat here. Now, the French are not the only ones who want American bodies. Thanks to that London Agreement, Pershing has a number of American divisions that are training and fighting with the Brits. And once he establishes the First Army, he's demanding that Douglas Haig, the commander of the British Army, give him back his divisions. Now, Haig, fresh off his victories at Amiens, is saying, why would I give up these troops when I'm being successful? You keep to reinforce success. And after a lot of wrangling back and forth, he gives up most of the division, but Pershing grudgingly allows him to retain the 2nd Corps, whose emblem is the American Eagle and the British Lion, along with the 22nd and 30th Divisions. And they will fight with the British Army despite his protests against amalgamation to the end of the war. So what do we make of this campaign? These 3 months. When the Americans are honest with themselves, they are both worried and proud. They are proud that they have stood against the German army and proven themselves to be equal to the British and the French. But they're also cognizant of the fact that this is an army that is not ready for prime time. And this is the butcher's bill for those 3 months, 54,000 dead. And most of those dead are due to the fact that the American army was simply thrown into the battle before they were ready. Now, they're not the only ones that were evaluating the Americans. The Germans are also quite honest in their assessment of the American fighting capability. And if you look at the German reports that we capture after the war, time and time again the Germans say the Americans are brave, but they're also quite foolhardy. And they'll go on to sort of whistle past the graveyard and give sour grapes about how poor the American army is, how bad the leaders are, how bad their tactics are. And it's all true. But at the same time, there's a deep hint of fear in what the Germans are saying. That despite our machine guns and despite our artillery and despite the heavy casualties that the Americans had endured, they kept coming. Last but not least, we also have the French. I like that first one of the 77th Division. The troops were very courageously led, but the officers had a total misunderstanding of war. And there's some truth there. Time and time again, the Americans will criticize the French during these months, that the Americans suffered unnecessary casualties because the French were too slow on their flanks. And there's some truth to that. And the Americans will say, time and time again, the French commanders that the Americans served with pushed the Americans into the worst part of the fighting to save French lives. And the French have been doing this since 1914, so there's some truth in that too. But the God's honest truth is, the French had learned hard-won battlefield wisdom. And when they are moving slower than the Americans, it's because they learn that when you move slow, you keep up with the artillery. And so whether it's the attack with the 2nd Division, the 167th French Division, or the attacks at Soissons, the French are able to achieve their objectives with much fewer casualties than the Americans. At the same time, though, the French respect the fact that the Americans are here, and they seem to be committed to the cause, and they're willing to sacrifice everything they have for the war effort. What does it all matter? In 3 months of fighting and 50-odd thousand casualties, the Americans have finally earned the right to have an independent army in France. And in the midst of the fighting and the end Marne, Foch calls up Pershing and says, now is the time. I'm going to be the most popular American in the world who's not an American. You can have your army. And Pershing then establishes the 1st U.S. Army is an operational force on the 10th of August, 1918. We'll do the rest of the story in a couple of months when we talk about Samuel and the Meuse-Argonne. I started off with cool pictures of Americans bayonet and Germans. I got to end on cool pictures of Americans bayonet and Germans. What are your questions?
Folks, you are welcome to come down to either mic, or if you'd just like to raise your hand, I can come to you.
Sean, outstanding. I have a question. On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the best, how would you rank Pershing during the war?
6.
Would you explain?
No, just 6. No. Pershing is a brilliant organizer. In fact, the AEF is willed into existence by the sheer force of power of John J. Pershing. Again, he's going up against some pretty tough operators. Ferdinand Foch is a tough cookie, and it takes a lot to stare that guy down. So he is very good at bringing this thing together. and to make sure that there is an American army that fulfills President Wilson's desire. When it comes to an operational commander, he's out of his depth. And I don't want to give away the secrets. For the next one, we'll talk about the Meuse-Argonne. And arguably the most courageous thing that Pershing ever does as a commander is as admits when he's out of his depth. And so in the middle of October 1918, he will relinquish operational control of the U.S. First Army so he can focus in on the big things. He's great war, good enough. He's not amongst the best. Arguably, Foch is probably the best operational strategic level in my estimation of the war for a host of reasons. But he's good enough to meet the American goals. Does that answer your question? Good. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Faulkner. I have a question. One of your early slides, you showed what an Army regiment looked like in 1916.
Yes.
And that was perfectly sized to guard the border with Mexico.
Absolutely.
Or whatever. And 18 months later, it's more than twice as large and reorganized down to the smallest level. How did they get there in 18 months? Did they copy someone else? Did they experiment? How did that happen?
Not well. I would go as far to argue as that the American Army really never has a doctrine in World War I. That Pershing has this nebulous idea of open warfare where superior American riflemen and mobility are going to finally bring mobility back to the battlefield. But we are copying and pasting every doctrinal manual we can find from the British and the French. And sometimes it's almost comical. There's a publication that comes out of the Army War College in early 1918 that is basically a word-for-word translation from the French. But the illustrations in the back, and they're beautiful illustrations showing how soldiers need to attack, come from a British manual. And the manual itself makes no effort to sort of reconcile that. So the American doctrine is a pickup game of stuff that we get from our old doctrine, plus what they learned from the British, what they learned from the French, and basically through that ugly school of hard knocks in combat, how the soldiers that live, survive, figure it out themselves. Yeah, great question.
This will be our last question over to our left.
Thank you, and I can't wait for the cliffhanger in a couple of months. All right, here we go.
When we last left our heroes.
Could you just take us back and give us a day in that battle at Belleau Woods when you kept saying the Marines were bashed? Can you give us a little more on the bashed part?
Yeah. 6 June, 7 June, 8 June, 9 June. And it's sort of the same thing, that the Germans occupy high ground, and it's already a very heavily wooded area. The minute that the German advance grinds to a halt, von Kotta's corps starts to dig in. And it's already a very naturally defensible area. And once you start doing these slit trenches and all, and using the very well-developed German defensive doctrine applied to that terrain, it's just a really tough nut to crack. And so without adequate artillery preparation, you have these waves of Marine infantry basically walking dead into concentrations of German artillery and machine guns. They'll try to work out the Marines, and Harvard will try to work out some of the artillery. So they'll start to shell the woods, but then what happens with the wood, once you start to shell it, is you get the fallen trees, and it creates even worse obstacles. So the Marines are really doing a series of uncoordinated attacks through very difficult terrain to try to roust the Germans out. And to the Marines' credit, the Germans sort of grasp onto this as a key battle that they can't lose either. That a report goes out from the German high command that says, you know, if we let these guys win here, their first divisional battle, it's going to elevate the morale not only of the Americans but also of the French and the British. So they keep feeding troops in too. So it becomes a killing ground for both sides. Very much like the wilderness, yeah, except with machine guns and mustard gas. So even worse. Good question. Did that answer what you were looking for? Good.
Folks, on behalf of your National World War I Museum Memorial, thank you very much for joining us here this evening. And another round of applause for Dr. Sean Faulkner.
Thank you.